I'm Zor. Welcome to Unizor Education, Mathematics for Teenagers. Today's lecture will be about numerical systems. All right. We have already talked about some ancient people who invented the concept of a number, purely abstract number, and now they can measure quantities, 15 sheep or 15 bulls or 15 stones or whatever else. They're all represented by a number 15. Now they have to be able to write it down. Why? Because ancient lawyers had to write down some contracts about the person X bought from person Y 15 sheep. So they had to put some number 15 in writing. Well, how did they do it? The first and most primitive system is obviously to have 15 written as this. So all these cavemen were using whatever tools they have to put vertical bars on stones. Well, it's very slow and very inconvenient and kind of lengthy. You need too many stones to write it down. So, we need some other system. And obviously, I will be talking about different numerical systems which people have invented throughout the years. But first, I would like to invent my own, which is just an example of how different people approach different problems. So, I don't like that this is too long, right? So I would like to shorten it down. How can I do it? Okay, I came up with a purely arbitrary number 4, and I will group these bars into groups of 4. So I have 1, 2, 3 complete groups of 4, and 1 incomplete, which contains only 3 vertical bars. Right, so I invent a special symbol to represent 4 strikes, 4 bars in the group. And this symbol will be a square. So I have another square for the second full group and for the third one. And for an incomplete group, I will have different symbol which represents how many bars are in this incomplete group. So if 4 represent the complete group and square, I will use the triangle, let's say, to represent 3 bars here. So my number 15 is represented in this way in my numerical system. Well, what's the number 14? Well, it will be obviously 3 full squares and 2 in an incomplete group. So I will invent plus to represent number 2. What else? Number 7, let's say. Well, 7 is a complete group of 4 and 3, which is a triangle. Number 5 would be 1 complete square, which is 4, and let's say a vertical bar, which is representation of 1. So any relatively small number, I can represent a certain number of full squares, and at the end, I will have whatever number of bars I have left in an incomplete group. Obviously, I will have to have as many characters, different characters, as big the size of my group is. So if my size of the group is 4, I need 4 characters to represent either a complete group of 4 or incomplete group of 3 or 2 or 1. So number of characters altogether, which I have to remember, is exactly equal to the group size. So that's good, actually, because I have to remember maybe a little bit more instead of just 1 vertical bar. I have to remember 4 different characters, but it shortens my notation by the factor of 4, obviously. Okay, fine. Romans did something just one step further than that. By the way, before I go to Romans, if instead of group size of 4, I would choose, let's say, 100, in my notation, what would I do? Well, I would have to invent a symbol to represent 1, 2, 3, 4, for all these different incomplete groups which are possible, up to 99 and then to 100. So I have to have 100 different symbols to represent different sizes of the group. This is a little bit too much. So it's a little bit more convenient because it will shorten my notation by a factor of 100. But obviously the negative side is that I have to remember too many symbols to represent different quantities. Well, Romans did something smarter than that. First, they also have decided that we will have a certain group size which will be represented by a one particular symbol. Well, in my case, for a group size of 4, I used square. Romans did, for a group size of 1,000, they used the letter M. Well, probably related to legend, millennium or something. All right, so now we have groups of 1,000. And if I have a big number, let's say 3,000 something, they can put three letters M, which represent 3,000, and then something. Well, something in my previous notation, when I had only one fixed group size, I had to invent a special symbol for every quantity from one to a group size. Well, in this case, if we don't have any other rules and agreements about this system, it means that now, after putting 3,000, I have to have a special symbol which represents 1, 2, 3, up to 1,000, right? Well, that's not very convenient. So, Romans were much smarter than I am, and they have decided, all right, the remainder, which is a number from like 0 to 999, we will also group into different groups. We will group it in groups of 500. And they have invented a different character, different symbol for 500, which is D. So, if you have a number, let's say 3,752, I will use 3,752 in our decimal system. So I put this 10 as an index. So 700, if you have a group of 500s, can be represented as one full group, which is 500, right? And then you still have 252 in the remainder. So you have to have, maybe, if you're not smart like Romans, you have to have additionally characters from 1 to 499 to be represented in one single character, right? But they have decided, no, we will break it down again into groups of 100. So whatever is left after 3,500, and there are 252, right, in decimal, well, they will break into groups of the 100s right now. They have invented another character, C, for 100. So 252 is two letters C, which means 200. Now we have 52 in the remainder. Well, they have invented another character, L, for 50. So 52 can be represented as 50. And now I have to have a representation of only number 2, which is a remainder. Well, they actually have a little bit more. They have X for 10, V for 5, and then I for single digit 1. So by using the combination of these symbols, they can write any number. So in this case, I just have to add 2 ones to get 3,752. Well, let's just, as a representation, do another number in the Roman system. And I'll show you a little trick which they did. So this is smart, actually, what they did. They have used different group size. sizes. In my case, I used only one group size, 4. They have decided that they will use big groups, like 1,000, to cover big numbers, and whatever remainder is, they had a smaller group sizes. So again, let's talk about M, B, C, L, X, B, and I, which represent 1,000 in decimal system, 500 in decimal system, 100 in decimal, 50 in decimal, 10 in decimal, 5, and 1 in decimal system. Right. Using these, we will have 3,798, let's say. Even better, 99. Well, let's try to construct this number from these components. First, we have 3 big groups of 1,000. Now, we have 700, which can be constructed from certain number of D's, right? So it's D, that's 500. No more 500s, so we have 299 left. 299, so we have to use C 2 times, right? Then we have 99, which is 50, and 410, that's 90. L, 410s. And now we have 9 as a remainder. So 9 can be written as, I'll continue this, as 5 and 4 ones, right? Well, now, what exactly a trick I was talking to you about? Very simple. Instead of representing 9 as V and 4 vertical bars, 4 eyes, instead of that, they have decided we will do a different thing. Instead of adding 5 and 4 ones, they will use subtraction. If a smaller representation of 1 is preceding a bigger one, 10 in this case, you have to subtract it instead of adding. So this is a representation of 9. So instead of this, we will use this at the end. Similarly with this, this is 90. Instead of using L and 3 X's, we will use X and C. And this means subtract 10 from 100, and that will be 90. And then subtract 1 from 10 would be 9. So this is basically 3,799. Am I right? I think I'm right. Well, in any case, trick or not trick, this is a system which is one step further from my primitive system when I just divided by groups. And the improvement is they have different group sizes. Bigger groups, and then smaller groups to represent smaller numbers. Great. And now we will go to something which we conveniently use every day. And we call it usually Arabic system, which actually represents only the involvement. Arabs were involved in basically transporting this system from Indians who really invented it to Europeans. So this is a system which is a positioning system. Based 10 positioning system, instead of inventing a special symbol to represent bigger and bigger numbers, they have a very limited number of symbols. Base 10 system has only 10 different symbols, which we all know from 0 to 9. And it's not the symbol by itself which represents certain number. It's a symbol which also is positioned correspondingly to the magnitude of the number. Number 1 means just 1. I mean, symbol 1 means just number 1. But if you put it in the second place from the right and put 0 in front of it, that means actually 10, as we all know, and this means 100, etc. So we are using this type of notation to represent our weights. So a digit which is on the first place on the right has certain weight, and a digit which is on the second place from the right has the weight of 10 times more, and the third one, it's 100 times more, 1,000 times more, etc. So if you have some number, what it actually means algebraically, base 10, this is 5 times 100 plus 6 times 10 plus 7 times 1. That's what it means. So this is a notation. This is an algebraic representation of this notation. Now I can actually write it slightly differently. It's 5 times 10 squared plus 6 times 10 to the first degree plus 7 times 10 to the zeroth degree. Right? Now, why is this better? Well, it actually represents that this is a base, and this, the power, is a position, basically. You see? 0, 1, and 2. 0, 1, and 2. So, in general, I can tell you that any number can be represented in this system using powers of 10 and certain multipliers, each one of them being from these numbers from 0 to 9. Well, obviously, algebra is trying to abstract and generalize everything. So, in theory, what we can do is we can invent a system, a positioning system, generalized positioning system, which has any number P as a base. Then, numbers from 0 to P minus 1 have to be somehow symbolized. Like if P is equal to 10, then we need numbers from 0 to 9. If P is 2, for instance, which is a binary system used in computers, then you need only from 0 to 1, only two characters, 0 and 1. If P is, let's say, 16, then you need certain symbolic representation of numbers from 0 to 15. To represent different remainder, whatever you have, if you divide by 16. So, and every number n now can be represented as certain multiplier times p to a certain degree, certain power of p, another multiplier on a smaller number, etc., and on the rightmost place, you will have this. So if you take only these multipliers and write them together, I put a bar on the top, which means it's not the multiplication, it's just you write one after another these digits. So this particular way of representing the number means this. And you have to have, obviously, say that P is the base of your system. So, let's just do a couple of exercises. If you have a number, let's say, 7, and you would like to represent this 7 written in decimal system as something in, let's say, binary system. Well, in binary system, it will be this. Why? Because the 1 is a multiplier, so this has weight of 2 to the 0 degree, to the 1st degree, to the 2nd degree, And if you will do this 1 times 2 to the 2nd degree plus 1 times 2 to the 1st degree plus 1 times 2 to the 0th degree, it will be 4 and 2 and 1, it will be exactly 7 in decimal system. Right? Now, what if I would like to represent it in a base 3 system? Well, in base 3 system, I have 1, 0, 1, and 2 as digits. So I have to represent it in a way like A. Well, I actually don't need K in general. Since it's a base 3, 3 squared is already 9, so it's only to the 1st degree plus 3 to the 0th degree. So what are my multipliers? Well, obviously this is supposed to be 2 times 3. So it's 2 times 3 to the 1st degree, that's 6, plus 1 to the 3 to the 0th degree. So the whole thing is becoming 21 in 3-based system. So 7 in decimal is 21 in tertiary system. All right, fine. What's the most important part about this, which mathematicians really have to take care of? If we don't talk about this, it's not mathematics. It's just some numerical exercise. The mathematicians do the following. First, they have to prove that for any number n and for any base p, there is such a representation. So always we can find such multipliers which would, combined with the whole expression, give us our number n. So one is an existence theorem, that this type of representation does exist. Secondly, we have to prove it's unique, which means if you have another representation of the same number in the same p-base system with different multipliers, let's say you have bj times p to the j degree plus bj minus 1 times p to the j minus 1 plus etc. plus b0 times p0. If you have a completely different representation of the same number using the same base but different multipliers, then it's exactly the same representation, which means the k should be equal to j, and all these multipliers should be equal to each other for I equals 0, 1, 2, etc. up to k. So this is a uniqueness. So not only representation should exist, but it also should be unique. Alright, these are two theorems which I would like you to prove, and maybe I will spend some other lecture to demonstrate it myself if I will have time. Anyway, this is a great exercise, and this is the real math. Everything else is just, you know, some kind of philosophical explanation, numerical systems, etc. This is not math. Proving uniqueness and existence of these two representations is something for real, and I would like you to do it. Thank you.